take my horse to the old town road. I'm gonna ride till I can't no more. I'm gonna take my horse to the old town road. I'm gonna ride till I can't no more.
We go together better than birds of a feather.
Tell
you
me
and
something,
me.
Girl.
Tell me something, boy.
Pull up in a demon on guard. Looking like I still do fraud.
Now it's everybody flocking, need a decoy. Shorty mixing up the vodka with the leak.
You're a tough guy, make it really rough guy. Just give me a lump, let her lead you on. You be saying you're not.
Don't think I fit in at this party. Oh yeah, yeah.
She said, where we going?
Yeah, I'm gonna take my heart to the old town.
Be patient, and one taught me pain.
I know I had to go and find out from there.
I'm fucking at a top, I
if
still
you really
ready.
Won't fall till you fall when you're back against the wall. And the
moon's got to know what we do. Hit me up when you fall.
Hey, I'm not feeling it.
Back to the left, level and deep. With it, don't go down.
Take
a sip.
Hey guys, Sean Faye Wolf of Diamond Deck Studios here in 2019 Broken Pop Music.
Hey Panini, don't you be a meanie. Thought you wanted me to go, or why you trying to keep me teeny?
You heard me right. Let it be known that as we rounded the final curve of the 2010s, we as a nation have collectively decided that any preconceptions we might have had about what popular music is and can be are as meaningless and shattered as the hopes that we would ever see Sweet Victory perform for real in a Super Bowl halftime show.
Let's get this over with. One, two, three, four.
You guys want to hear a sicko mode?
God, I love that clip. But yeah, believe it or not, that happened less than a year ago, on February 3rd of 2019. And in retrospect, I think that Super Bowl performance was the single pebble kicked off the mountaintop that triggered the massive rock slide, which utterly destroyed any rules or limitations on the types of music that could become popular in the United States. Think about what it says about 2019, that Bradley Cooper got knocked off the top of the charts by the Jonas Brothers, and that's just a minor footnote in this year's repertoire of madness. I mean, hell, the biggest breakout star of the year was a 17-year-old girl produced by a former Glee cast member whose first top 20 hit was this.
I wanna end me.
And it wasn't just Billy either. I dare you to name any other year in history where Truth Hurts or Seven Rings or Panini or even God's Country could have dominated the nation the way they did in 2019. Hell, even the Billboard charts, the industry standard for gauging musical popularity for over six decades, was brought to its knees by the 1-2 punch of Baby Shark and Old Town Road, opening the door for another music chart to challenge Billboard for the first time in over 20 years. 2019 was the year that the very foundations of how we think about and interact with music became shakier by the day. And I could go on and on about every individual droplet of insanity that 2019 managed to wring out of the music world, but we just don't have time for that. And besides, intrigue is not the same thing as actual quality, so taking all the insanity of the year and shoving it to the side, how do we do in 2019? Honestly, really well is how we did. 2019 has easily been one of the best years for pop music in the 2010s. Not the best year, but one of the best. And what's interesting is that this isn't because 2019 had way more amazing pop music than your average year, it just had way less bad pop music than your average year. The overall quality of the top 40 just seemed to bump up half a dozen notches overnight between 2018 and 2019, and naturally that made putting this ranking together pretty difficult. It really was a struggle to find 10 songs to fill this list, and honestly, even the ones I picked, I just don't have an axe to grind with them the same way I did last year. A good number of these songs are mostly just mediocre, with maybe one or two particular elements that really grate on me. However, one point that I often feel gets overlooked when making worst hit songs lists like this is that these aren't just bad songs. These are bad songs that millions of people actively chose to listen to. Even if most of these picks aren't the worst songs ever, the fact of the matter is that whatever you were listening to this year, more people were listening to the songs on this list. And in a year where the general public was willing to look further and wider than ever before to find the music they wanted, this is particularly egregious. Now, I can't wait to dive into this particular lot of garbage, but first, a few ground rules. Like always, a song only qualifies for this list if it's predicted to make Billboard's 2019 year-end Hot 100. So just keep that in mind before you ask why this list isn't filled with deep cuts from the underbelly of SoundCloud or anything like that. Also, unlike last year, I'm gonna allow songs onto this list even if they're probably gonna be bigger hits in 2020 than in 2019, because then I can just avoid unnecessary predictions. And last but not least, please be sure to stick around until the very end of the video, because I will be going over some dishonorable mentions after I talk about the last proper entry. And with that, I think we're about ready to go. Let's saddle up and take a headfirst dive into the top 10 worst hit songs of 2019.
Here's to the ones that we got. Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not. Cause the drinks bring back all the memories of everything we've been through.
I'm that bad type, make your mama sad type, make your girlfriend mad type, might seduce your dad type. I'm the bad guy.
Bad Guy by Billie Eilish will not be on this list.
Duh.
It seems like I spent about half of this past year trying to explain why this song got under my skin so much, even though pretty much every other person I talk to online seems to regard it as a masterpiece, or if not that, then at least a really solid pop song. I'm frankly kind of floored that I seem to be the only person put off by the fact that this song is about an underage girl seducing a much older man just to freak her parents out, but it's basically also the plot of Twilight, so clearly there's a big market for this. A part of me did seriously consider putting this song in the top 10, because it really does make me uncomfortable, but at the end of the day, I can't deny that another part of me can't help but be impressed by it. Billie Eilish had a distinct vision for a weird-ass song that she genuinely wanted to make, and it conquered the world. Even in spite of some unfortunate implications, I can say the fact that the public embraced Billie and this song so wholeheartedly really does give me hope for the direction that mainstream music is heading. Of course, if you're looking for a massive hit from this year that's an impersonal, focus-grouped mess that reeks of payola and tampering by industry insiders, you do have your options.
Yeah, come on.
Please me, baby. Turn around and just tease me, baby. You got what I want and what I need, baby.
Let me hear you say.
Yeah, Billie can try to take credit for it all she wants, but this is the massive hit from 2019 that made my soul so cynical. Back in 2017, I said that it felt like the tides of mainstream music were being controlled by the people for the first time in years. But in retrospect, this was mainly because 17 was the first year that streaming totally dominated the music world. Most of the songs that were actually being streamed were still very industry-friendly in hindsight, and the past few years have seen the labels grasping onto power and using radio manipulation and other sketchy promotional tactics to try and force the music that they want to be popular down our throats. But ever since 2017, cracks have started to show in the armor. I mean, say what you will about them, and trust me, I have, but there is no way that 6ix9ine or XXXTentacion should have been able to go mainstream like they did last year. You know, for more reasons than the obvious. And that's to say nothing of this year, where not only did Billie Eilish break through, but a team-up between a 19-year-old meme lord and Hannah Montana's dad managed to completely stymie the entire music industry for 5 months straight. 2019 has been the most populist year for mainstream music that I can remember, and that's only made the obvious industry plans all the more icky, with none being more blatant about it than Please Me.
Don't want no young dumb shit, better fight me like we listening to Jodeci.
Now, I'll be the first to admit that this song isn't devoid of positive qualities. Cardi still has a decent flow, a nice singing voice, and some natural charisma to lean on, and some of the production work is impressive. But something just rubbed me the wrong way about Please Me from the beginning. And I'm not just talking about the obvious recycling. When I walk away with you, I watch the whole room change. Yes, Finesse was one of my favorite hit songs from last year. It was an awesome New Jack Swing throwback, and Bruno and Cardi worked together perfectly there because, well, one's the Uptown Funk guy and the other turned into Left Eye Lopez for 3.5 minutes. Now, in a reasonable world, we would have said, wow, that was a great song, and then moved on with our lives. But apparently the good folks at Atlantic Records came to the conclusion that Gucci Mane wouldn't be enough to keep Bruno relevant until he got the next album out. And so, bada bing, bada boom, Cardi and Bruno have to make another Finesse. Just, you know, bad this time.
Let me hear you say,
please.
Let me hear you say,
please.
Just listen to all those synths. Like a dozen disparate tones all hitting at once with no grace or form or style to them. Just piling all up on that chorus like a car crash. The song is produced by The Stereotypes, the same people who produced Finesse. But while that song was tight and controlled throughout the whole thing, the main hook on this is just a giant sluggish glob of sound. Please Me gives off the vibe of a song made by a bunch of very talented people who just didn't want to be working on it. And nowhere is that more evident than in the vocals. Granted, Cardi B still does fine on here because, well, she's Cardi, and say what you will about her, but she never half-asses anything. She still manages to have the worst moment in the song, though.
Bro, bitches, watch out now. Watch out. Yo pussy basura. My pussy ochata.
Oh, sweet Jesus.
But while Cardi may have the worst individual moment, it's really Bruno who drags the whole thing down. I mean, Bruno isn't typically one to half-ass things either, but it has been known to happen before. And when it does, it results in stuff like...
Sky full of lighters.
And...
She's gonna scream out, this is great.
Oh my god, this is great.
And...
Bubble butt, bubble, bubble, bubble butt, bubble butt.
Wait, what the what? Bruno's on this? Where? He did the hook? That's Bruno's voice?
Bubble butt, bubble, bubble, bubble butt, bubble butt, bubble, bubble.
Dude, how did Todd not rip your head off with his bare hands and mount it on a pike above the London Bridge?
Please me, baby, turn around and just tease me, baby.
Well, thankfully Bruno doesn't do that here.
What the fuck?
But he does sound drunk out of his mind, and the more I listen to it, the more I'm sure that it had to be intentional. Why else would he be delivering his lines so slurred and just ever so slightly offbeat in the most infuriating way?
You know what I want and what I need, baby.
Let me hear you say,
please.
Let me hear you say.
Frankly, once Cardi stops teasing him and finally gives him what he's asking for, I'm not sure he'd even be up to returning the favor, because the dude's clearly swimming neck deep in liquor on this track. Well, either that or he's giving a career-worst R&B performance. One of the two. Despite all of that, though, this song really doesn't sound terrible. I don't know if I'd even call it bad, really. It just feels really slimy. When I hear Please Me, I don't hear a song that came from any sort of artistic vision. I hear a project rushed out of the studio to bolster Bruno's career by trying to remake a good song that everybody liked after Wake Up in the Sky didn't rehabilitate his image after the bad press from his Grammy win. Propped up by Radio Payola and AstroTurf in an era where people are more sick of the establishment and corporate overreach than ever. It wasn't a good move, and it isn't a good song. I'm sure there are people out there who genuinely enjoy listening to this, but with the exception of my rival Fly Swatter, I haven't met them, and I doubt I ever will, because 8 months later, and this song's already been forgotten. Please Me Es Basura, Finesse Es Horchata. Next.
Let me hear you say,
please.
Toast to the ones in today. Toast to the ones that we lost on the way. Cause the drinks bring back all the memories, and the memories bring back your...
Well, that took longer than I expected. Where the hell did I find so much to say about Please Me of all fucking things? But anyway, regardless, yeah, that did take a little bit longer than I expected, so I should probably try and keep this next entry a little bit shorter. What am I talking about here?
Hey, I'm in the studio, bro.
Yeah, this won't take long.
I wake up in the morning, I got murder on my mind. AK-47s, Mac 11s, Glock 9s.
Okay, we've got a very unbalanced ratio of shit to unpack versus amount of attention this guy deserves, so let's just get through this. See this guy here? His name is Jamel Maurice Demons, better known as YNW Melly. He's a 20-year-old SoundCloud rapper from Florida who broke through early this year after snagging a feature from world-renowned evangelist slash Roblox femdom enthusiast Kanye West. However, while that feature may have been what put him on the map, it was ultimately overshadowed by Murder on My Mind, a mournful trap song from early 2017 where Melly reflects from inside his jail cell after he accidentally kills one of his friends.
I didn't even mean to shoot him. He just called me by surprise.
While this song saw basically no success on its initial release, it rocketed up the charts this spring after Melly turned himself in on charges of the real-life double murder of two of his posse members in a situation that, hauntingly, almost perfectly mirrors the fictional murder in the song.
I told him it's too late, my friend, it's time to say goodbye, and he died inside my arms.
So, let's start by addressing the elephant in the room. All you have to do is look at the comments under the song's YouTube video to see that a pretty high percentage of people who stream this song thought they were listening to the confessions of a murderer, apparently unaware of the fact that this song was released a year and a half before the incident happened. I personally find it kind of disgusting that we have yet another scumbag whose career got a massive boost because of an unspeakably horrible crime that he committed, but at the same time, I can't blame people for their natural curiosity. Certainly the whole YNW Melly situation was one of the most intensely gripping musical stories of 2019, even if it was for all the wrong reasons. Further complicating my feelings towards all this is the fact that Murder on My Mind is actually kind of impressive as a piece of music. The production is swamped out, yet also gritty and melodic. Melly's entrancing flow fits the somber tone beautifully, and the songwriting really is powerful. He starts off by reflecting on how he's lost everyone he cares about and trusts, and then follows it up with a heart-wrenching second verse where he goes over the murder itself in excruciating detail.
His body dropped down to the floor and he had teardrops in his eyes. He grabbed me by my hands and said he was afraid to die.
It's an extremely effective verse that really makes you feel the sheer gravity of this death, and as much as it pains me to say it, I have to commend it for that. So if I apparently find this song so impressive, then what is it doing on this list? Is it really only here because of the guy who made it and the circumstances that made it popular? The answer to that question is no. This is why it's on here.
I'm a tarantula, bitch, I'm an animal. Melly's a savage, no, he not no amateur. Bitch, I'm a murderer.
Yes.
I'm a dickhead.
Yep. After two verses of devastating regret over the life he's taken, this is how Melly chooses to close out the song. By rapping about what a dangerous killer he is and how he doesn't give two shits about the path of destruction he leaves in his wake.
Murder on my mind.
And wrapping it all up with the most irritating laugh I've heard in a song since Anaconda, because tonal consistency is for narcs.
I got murder on my mind.
I was tempted to put this song way lower on this list just because of that third verse alone, and I won't lie and say that the context of this song's popularity doesn't make that last verse many, many times harder to sit through. But the rest of the song is so effective that I really can't justify putting it any lower than here. And honestly, this whole affair just makes me feel more sad than anything else. YNW Melly should have been a promising new name in the hip-hop landscape, but instead he can only watch from behind prison bars as he gets nothing but the same quick glances of morbid curiosity that cause traffic jams after a car crash. So much wasted potential. Hell, so much waste in general. Ugh.
There's a time that I remember when I did not know no pain, when I believed in forever and everything would stay the same.
So apparently it's cool to like country music now.
I got the horses in the bag.
In the early spring of 2019, a black chowder stand on TikTok decided to wear a cowboy hat. And within 4 months, the entire United States had erupted into a ferocious year-long debate over what country music even was anymore, and whether the entire notion of genre was antiquated at best or racist at worst. But while the Old Town Road discourse raged on Twitter, Billboard made a truly awe-inspiring series of bad PR moves, and think pieces hit the microblogs at the rate of an I Love Lucy conveyor belt, country music of all types took that limelight and ran with it, resulting in the most commercially successful year for the genre since the heyday of Garth Brooks. Of course, you know as well as I do that this is a worst list, and so I bet you're wondering what particular flavor of Nashville I found to be unpalatable enough to feature on this list. You may be thinking that I picked Speechless by Dan and Shay for taking the goodwill they earned from tequila and using it to transform into one of the most genuinely flavorless acts I've ever heard. Or maybe One Thing Right by Kane Brown, aka the song that gave this guy a number one country hit. Or perhaps Talk You Out of It by Florida Georgia Line, a song named after a gross dad joke and anchored by a classic R&B reference so out of place that Charlie Puth is giving them the stink eye. But no, the song that I picked for this spot is... well, it's a traditional love ballad. By an idiot.
No matter where we go, no matter what we do, if you're there, girl, I've got my eyes on you.
Out of the entire cornucopia of country songs by all these crazy new artists this year, this was the only one that actively got under my skin. Then again, to call Chase Rice a new artist is kinda misleading, because he's been bubbling under the surface of the country scene for the past half a decade, even though he never had that big breakthrough. This was his biggest hit before this year.
Damn pretty girl, you ain't done it again. You're gonna turn it sexy.
Okay, I'd say that's bad enough of that for one existence.
Evas run and feel the heat between us two.
Yeah, Chase Rice got started right at the peak of the bro country boom, and like I said, he didn't even do that well. Presumably because the same audience that couldn't get enough of Luke Bryan just didn't find Chase Rice to be interesting or talented enough. Fortunately, I think the bro country era was finally abandoned for good a couple years back and left to die in the middle of nowhere on a body-shaped back road. So what we've got here is not bro country, but rather Chase Rice trying his hand at a poppier love ballad in the lane of Perfect by Ed Sheeran. The gist of it is that Rice and his girl have been all around the world and seen all of these beautiful vistas and locations, but even after all of that, the most beautiful thing that he's ever seen is her. Aw, that's so cute I could puke.
Rainbow bleh!
Don't matter where we've been, no there ain't no better.
Yeah, apparently this woman is just so radiant and breathtaking that even though they've traveled to all these amazing places, she's still the main attraction wherever they go. Might as well have just stayed in the room, am I right?
Might as well have stayed in the room.
I was kidding, dude. Like, I get that your girl's pretty and all that, and that's great and all, but don't say that to her. I mean, that just makes it sound like you weren't even paying attention and that you did all these amazing things with her and you just didn't care about them.
Don't you remember Times Square? People counting down everywhere. 2000 whatever, no, I didn't care. 'Cause baby, you were there.
Dude, you realize that there's more to life than just ogling at how hot your girlfriend is, right? And on top of that, why did you phrase it like that? I didn't care because you were there? What, are you trying to make her feel like it was her fault?
But ain't got much memory of the scenes, come to think I missed them all. And damn, babe, it's all your fault.
What are you doing?
You still talk about that moon that I can't recall. But God, I saw all I needed to.
Alright, ladies and gentlemen, here we have a first-class example of taking a kinda cute and playful idea and running it way too far in a way too literal direction. Saying that your girlfriend is more beautiful than all the places you saw when sightseeing, whatever, that's kinda cute. But saying that she's so beautiful that you're literally not capable of looking at anything else and you don't even remember those experiences that you shared together because you were too busy staring at her? I'm sorry, that's just weird and off-putting. And before you go off on me, I know the whole thing is supposed to be tongue-in-cheek and cute, but I honestly don't find it cute at all. If my partner were to sing this song at me, all I would hear is that she cared more about the way I looked than she did about spending time and sharing experiences with me. Even if you read the entire song as hyperbole like I'm sure you're supposed to, it still has that subtext and it just doesn't sit right with me. If he had talked about all the beautiful experiences they've shared together and then ended by saying that she was more beautiful than all of it, then maybe that could have worked. But instead, all we've got is yet another meathead trying to appear romantic while completely failing to hide the fact that his dick is still the one calling the shots. Oh, and the Sam Hunt speak singing thing isn't helping matters either.
Driven up and down the coast a few times, the
London, Paris, paradise.
And I'm sure one of your friends is about to come over here, cause she's supposed to save you from random guys that talk too much.
Yeah, cause that's a song whose legacy I want to remain alive. Chase Rice. Seriously, who the hell even is this guy? I mean, has he ever done anything with any sort of real impact?
Baby, your song, you made me wanna roll my windows down and groan.
Oh. So, he's the Julia Michaels of country.
I got issues, but you got them too.
Well, that's good. It means I won't ever have to think about him again.
I was with my eyes on.
Now my heart feel like December, when somebody say your name. Cause I can't reach out to call you, but I know I will one day,
yeah. 2019 was a year of one massive shakeup after another in the music world, and I think it's pretty undeniable that the rules of popular music aren't the same as they were 12 months ago. A lot of things have changed, some of which I alluded to in the intro, and some of which I'll talk about later, and I'm fascinated to see where these new norms will take us as we head forward into the new decade. However, one thing that did not change in 2019 is the phenomenon of songs being made by absolutely atrocious human beings that still managed to become these massive smash hits in spite of all the baggage that comes with them. We've already talked about one such cretin on this list. We're about to talk about another one, and spoilers, there are gonna be a few more down the road. But you know, at least YNW Melly has some degree of talent, and the music he makes is interesting and personal. I can definitely see why some people are willing and able to overlook the terrible things he's done and appreciate his art on its own merits. The same cannot be said about Chris Brown.
Little baby in a bag in a Birkin.
2020 will mark 15 years since the start of Breezy's hit-making career. Over those 15 years, this man has assaulted Rihanna and sent her to the emergency room, called Frank Ocean a faggot and punched him out while fighting over a parking spot, gotten restraining orders from several ex-girlfriends for stalking, violence, and alleged rape, among other things, been repeatedly involved in brawls, hit-and-runs, and violent fits of anger, been kicked out of at least half a dozen rehab and medical facilities trying to help him, and, of course, features on a song about how awesome his life is that boils everything I just said down into a throwaway gag.
Ain't nobody judging cause I'm black or my controversial past. I'ma go and see a movie and relax.
Now, I go back and forth about how much the things an artist does in their personal life should affect the way I view their music, and I think it's something that, generally speaking, needs to be taken on a case-by-case basis. I'm usually able to overlook a certain degree of artist baggage if the subject of the song doesn't explicitly tie into what they did. Hell, two of my best lists from other years have R. Kelly songs on them, for God's sake. So I hope you believe me when I tell you that I don't automatically call a song bad just because it was made by a disgusting human being. But when it comes to Chris Brown, even if his personal life made Danny Tanner look like Tyler Durden, that wouldn't change the fact that he's one of the most profoundly mediocre artists to ever become an A-list celebrity. He doesn't have a good voice, his trademark sound is some of the most strange and poorly mixed autotune I've ever heard, and he's not particularly smooth or charismatic or well-spoken or, well, anything, really. And on no guidance, not only do you have to listen to Chris Brown trying to seduce this girl with some of the most overdone, cliched, and unconvincing posturing I've heard in a long time, but you're stuck with him for an excruciating 4.5 minutes. This song was easily the most sluggish, cumbersome drag to hit the top 10 this year. I mean, just think about what it says about this song when Drake, fucking Drake, is a more convincing ladies' man than you are. Now, I will grant that the song's beat, while still an ambient drone, is definitely an upgrade over Back to Sleep, the song that No Guidance is clearly trying to remake. However, the lyrical quality has not stepped up even an inch, as I will demonstrate by taking a look at... Got that, ladies? Mr. Brown isn't looking to play any silly games or anything like that. No, no. He's just looking to fuck around with you. I'm glad we got that cleared up. Also, the last name thing? It's been done.
Patty cake with no hands. Got me in this club making wedding plans.
Guess there are only so many unique ways to be a shitty Usher knockoff. They were bound to cross paths eventually. is Usher anyway?
All you need is me playing on your playlist.
Oh, come on, man. Even if you're gonna be a possessive control freak, have some mercy on this girl. Your only song in the past 5 years that people liked enough to make a hit was a joke song where you had to pretend you had a micro penis. Don't subject her to your shitty playlists.
Seen it on the ground, trying to see that shit in 3D, mommy.
Oh, I see. So you haven't even met this girl you're trying to seduce? So what's going on here? Are you just creeping on Instagram models, or are you trying to pull a pro Jared over on your fans? I need some clarity on the specific awful behavior I have to reprimand here.
Blue to Cooper 17, no guidance.
So, that lyric is the one that's so important to you that the entire song gets named after it? Are you trying to say that the most important quality in the girl to you is that she was put in a shitty situation from a young age and she's struggling to figure out her place in the world, which makes her an easy target for you to prey on? Actually, don't answer that. Yes. Yes, that's exactly what you were trying to say. Yeah, Chris Brown appreciates a woman being perfect for the same reason that a bowler appreciates a perfectly arranged line of pins. Strike. You're out. We're on the dawn of a new decade, America. Let's do ourselves a favor and leave this worthless creep in the last one.
Ooh, wow. Chris Brown, dancer extraordinaire. Wow, whoa, whoa. Right?
Everybody hurts sometimes, everybody hurts someday, yeah, yeah. But everything gon' be alright, gon' raise a glass and say, yeah.
And on the subject of people whose careers had better not live to see the 2020s.
We got London on the track.
Swerving, how you look so perfect on your worst day. Double C, it purchase, you deserve it.
If you asked me to name a rapper who's not new, but who I didn't really pay any attention to until 2019, I think I'd have to point to A Boogie. I've been aware of this guy's existence for a while now, partially because of all the talk I've heard about how he's shaping the New York rap scene, and partially because once you hear a name as stupid as A Boogie with the hoodie, you're not gonna forget it. His career reached a new peak at the very beginning of 2019 with his sophomore album Hoodie SZN, and while it kinda struck me as a not-for-me type of album when I skimmed through it, it did finally help me to understand why A Boogie is such a big deal in the hip-hop world. He's got a solid grasp on dark ambient production, he's got an above-average ear for hooks, and he's one of the most versatile rappers working in the mainstream right now. The dude's got an entire Swiss Army knife's worth of flows to work with, and he's constantly switching between them on his song, with each having such a distinctive personality that it feels like he's featuring himself. And that's certainly true of this song, Swervin'. Over the course of it, he has a few very well-defined delivery styles and he's constantly switching between them.
Okay.
I'll fuck you from the back and leave you turning. The type to make you feel like I'm so worth it.
Shut up on my mind, I can't think straight. All my niggas rap, sounding like they scream.
You know, I was just wondering when someone would finally get the idea to take inspiration from Young Thug and Drake. I mean, clearly I've always thought that the roads paved by those two weren't nearly well-traveled enough. I mean, who knows? Maybe this'll be the start of some sort of novel new trend.
New Louboutin, you would think I'm bleeding from my toes.
Okay, so yeah, the flows, while impressive, are pretty obvious style jacks from two of the biggest names in music. On top of that, the beat is kinda thin and wears out pretty quickly, and while A Boogie's doing a good job blurring the line between late back and exciting with his delivery, the lyrics are not great.
Every little body love your surface. Yes, I'm along your body, make you nervous.
Wait, I thought you were trying to seduce this girl. Why the hell did you make her nervous?
I swear I ain't no killer, but test me if you want.
Oh, yeah, that'll do it.
Dig on inside of you, make you freeze, make you pose.
Dude, have you ever sexed before? Do me a favor, give it a shot, and then identify to me the exact moment where this makes her do this, and then report back to me.
Shit up on my mind, I can't think.
So yeah, bad punchlines, tonal mismatch in the lyrics, and a weak beat. Just another boring, by-the-numbers, disposable trap song with nothing particularly noteworthy about it. Oh, except for the pedophile.
Where these bitches at? I'm in the V with the tents. Got the effing on my body in the clip with hollow tips. Niggas said they gon' rob me and they still ain't do shit. Catch a weighing in the lobby and I'ma give it his dick. Man, where these niggas at? Man, where these niggas at? We gon' pull up big
bodies with the Rugas in the back. Okay. The comparative shift in tone between A Boogie's part and 6ix9ine's part is... Well, it's kind of like taking a baby and then spending a couple minutes wrapping it up in blankets and making it feel all nice and comfortable and safe, and then you punch it.
If a nigga wanna act out, got the Mac out, I ain't got no fucking back off, that's a man down.
I legitimately have no idea what the hell Tekashi is doing on this track, considering that his part is literally the exact opposite of everything the song is trying to do, tonally, lyrically, and musically. Honestly, I'm about to say this. That fucking thing he was doing on Fifi would have been 10 times better on this song than his ridiculous aggro shouting.
In the hole with them Billy niggas and them Hoover niggas.
This is another case where my thoughts on the artist's personal life are irrelevant to why I hate his part, but I still can't deny that the career of this man, who, need I remind you, made, published, and distributed a sex tape of himself and a literal child, and yet has been embraced and accepted by not just the rap scene, but the entire music industry, is one of the most genuinely shameful pop culture artifacts of the entire decade. Also, you may have noticed that 6ix9ine's part was, in fact, cut out of the music video. You may think that this was because A Boogie finally came to his senses and tried to pull a Prince Andrews and pretend that he never knew the guy, but considering the timing of the video, I'd say it's considerably more likely that A Boogie decided that after 6ix9ine started ratting out his posse and working with authorities, he didn't want to be seen on camera with him. I'm tempted to go on a rant about how a huge number of people see betraying his friends as the most dishonorable thing that 6ix9ine has done, but instead, I kinda wanna just appreciate this moment of unity. Say what you will about where people's tipping points were, but the fact is that I legitimately can't think of another human being who has so thoroughly and completely destroyed every single iota of respect that anybody would ever be willing to give him from every conceivable angle. He's a violent, murderous pedophile who has clear contempt for his listeners and snitched on his posse at the drop of a hat. And in a time where people are more divided than ever before, it's truly inspiring to see the entire world come together and unanimously condemn this subhuman scumbag to hell. Tekashi 6ix9ine. He may not be much of a rapper, but damn does that boy sing.
Here's to the ones that we got. Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not. Cause the dreams bring back all the memories of everything we've been through.
White shirt, now red, my bloody nose sleeping.
I just don't like You, Bad Guy by Billie Eilish. I mean, a lot of other people like you. I'm thrilled that a lot of other people like you, but I just don't like you. I've got a hunch that not only is Billie Eilish gonna be in this for the long haul, but years from now, this is only gonna be seen as the defining song of the first phase of her career, kind of like Love Story is for Taylor Swift. And you know what? If a Gen Z remake of The Graduate and a chorus of possessed hamsters is what it took to make Billie Eilish a household name, I'd say it was worth it. Both of my brothers really like this song, and for the life of me, I have no idea why. It's just dull, not catchy, not fun, and Bad Bunny is one of the most unpleasant vocalists working right now. The only value this song has to me is proving that Drake's monotone is so homogenous that he can literally switch languages and I don't even notice.
I don't wanna be somebody without your body.
This type of pop song died in 2016, and we really don't need it making a comeback.
This is my only fear that we become beautiful people.
Good God, guys, who hurt you?
I'm speechless.
At the end of last year, I said that Tequila was, and I quote, what mainstream country music should be. I think that statement is a testament to just how starved of organic sincerity last year really was. Because Dan and Shay does indeed seem to be where country music is headed, but I now realize that this is far from a good thing. While I still do like Tequila, all of their subsequent hits have been so completely middle of the road that they make Hootie and the Blowfish look like Avantasia. This song is a perfect demonstration of the problems with Dan and Shay's sound. Not upbeat enough to be fun, not smooth enough to be pleasant, not organic enough to be authentic, not sincere enough to be sweet.
I've been at the wrong place at the wrong time, chasing all the wrong things most of my life.
I'll go ahead and instantly destroy any credibility I have left by saying that I actually like Marshmello's drop on this quite a lot, but Kane Brown going on and on about what a miserable failure he is about everything is just more depressing than anything else. That's not the reason this is on here, though. One Thing Right makes the list because it feels like this is all of the worst trends in the country music of the 2010s besides bro country reaching their natural conclusion all in one place. The next time anyone tries to argue that Old Town Road deserved to be taken off the country charts because it wasn't authentic enough, just tell them that this was a number one country hit and see how they react.
We love the earth.
Here's another one that makes the list on principle, but I really don't hate as much as everybody else does. First of all, I flat out reject the notion that this is worse than Freaky Friday. Say what you will about its quality, but Earth is at least trying to get a sincere message about an important issue across, whereas Freaky Friday only exists so that a woman beater can brag about how big his dick is. Also, I don't care what anybody says, Ariana Grande playing a black and white zebra and Adam Levine playing a group of vultures who all have the same voice is so perfect that it couldn't have been a coincidence. And of course there's also this.
I'm a marijuana plant, I can get you fucked up.
And I'm Kanye West.
We love the Earth.
But yeah, outside of that, most of these jokes are really lame or sometimes non-existent. There are some pretty uncomfortable bits, and it does strike me as a bit hypocritical to make a charity song to raise money for the environment and then pair it up with one of the most expensive music videos ever made. Also, I'll just say it. Dickie seems way too impressed with himself for managing to put this whole thing together. And I am totally not saying that just because I'm salty that he managed to out-cameo my 2018 list. I mean, come on, dude. It's a charity single. You've clearly got a ton of insider connections, and you just reach out to all these people and ask them to literally give you 10 seconds of their time and effort so that they can get free exposure and shout out an important cause? That cannot have been that hard to do. Any idiot off the street could do that. Hell, I could do that!
Hi, I'm Kamari Fang, and I support Team Trees.
I'm Ducky, and you should check out Earth911.com.
My name is Andrew Prep, and this holiday season, I would recommend you look into and donate to the Trevor Project.
Hi guys, I'm King of the Void, and I support higher funding for public education.
I'm Lizette G, and I gotta ask, when's the last time you read a really good book?
Hey guys, it's John from ARTV, here to support the Arbor Day Foundation.
This is Ethan Gordon, previously known as the LP Club, and I'm here to talk to you about Bend the Arc, which is a political action committee mainly set up to help progressive causes in America, and I think you should check it out.
I'm the host of The Show With No Name, and I support adoption.
The Wonky Angle says trans rights.
I'm Inanimate Mashups, and I support the New South Wales Rural Fire Service.
Vote Bernie 2020.
Shout out to ActionAgainstHunger.org. This is Sound from Complex Ambition.
I'm Mr. 96, and medically accurate sex education is only mandated in 13 states.
Hey guys, Renner and Chase here, exercising my First Amendment rights cameo style. I'm just going to use this platform to say to buy some albums from some local bands. One band I'd recommend is a two-piece alternative rock band called Shakeout from Yonkers, New York, who are basically like a punk 21 Pilots.
Hi, I'm Sick of BOT1, and I believe that cancer should be outlawed. Nobody likes it anyway.
I'm Bed Reviews, and I support the National Sleep Foundation. Also lesbians in general.
Hello ladies, my name is Mr. 69, and how do I know more about sex than the entire state of Mississippi?
Hey guys, it's Matt from In the Furnace here, and I believe that if we all work together, we can each play a part in ending forest fires.
Hi, I'm the quotable Shyok, and I don't use plastic straws. I drink from a mug. Like a real man.
Hi, my name's Finn, and I support Four Oceans, and you're not gonna upload this without my permission again, are you?
This is Sans from Undertale, in affiliation with YouTube channel Maniac Pop, telling you to fight climate change, and remember...
Hi, Torgo's my name, and I'm here to talk about beating a dead horse.
Hi, I'm Bradley with a bread taste in music, and I think Lil Dicky should stop making music.
Hey guys, I'm the CHRD3, and I want to give a shout out to the Baghead Foundation.
Hi, I'm Brandon Croker, also known as the Baddy Man, and I represent the Casey Faye Wolf Fund. Hashtag justice for Casey, hashtag Casey still standing.
Yeah, I agree with what he said.
I'm Maniac Reviews, and I like to buy sheep on the dark web.
I'm that caveman-looking guy from Mortified Productions, and I advocate for Foley Frosted Pop-Tarts.
Hello everyone, I am the Double Agent. Androgenic alopecia affects billions of men worldwide. Visit spottheball.com to learn more.
Hey, it's the Mode of Views here, and I want to give a shout-out to the fantastic animal charity WTF.
Hi, I'm Loeco, and I'd like to ask you to take a look at my boy Gundar. Thank you for looking.
Hey guys, I'm LegendBTV, and we need to boycott KFC until they bring back their freshly baked cookies.
I'm RGS, an advocate for mental health awareness.
But today I'm advocating for tall men health awareness. For people like me who are 6 foot tall, because that's apparently way too much nowadays.
Hi, I'm Jesus Christ. And Chick-fil-A is a lot of things, but it's not sexy. Sorry, Kanye.
Hey, this is Drake Bell, and if you ever build a house in a tree or otherwise, make sure you cut out the door hole so you don't trap yourself inside of it. I think we've all been there.
Yo, this is Fabo from D4L, and I want to give a shout out to my favorite candy of all time, Starburst! Yeah! Can't read me!
I'm against drugs. Drugs are bad. You should not do them under any circumstance. In the eternal words of the great Nancy Reagan, just say no.
Mr. One and Only King of Hip Hop, Grandmaster Melly Mel, the last emperor of the hip hop culture. And that, my friend, is how you deliver a message. Trust me, I would know.
Indeed you would, Grandmaster. Good night, everybody.
Hey, yo, Mac,
ladies and gentlemen, C5.
Oh.
Wing time.
Oh.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Woo.
Zone, 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 zone.
Let me see your shoulders work. I mean, I don't know what y'all came here to do, but if you ain't got a lighter, what the fuck you smoking for?
We hot. What the fuck though?
Damn.
Where the love go?
Oh.
5, 4, 3, 2, I let one go.
Let's pow,
get the fuck though.
Bang.
I don't bluff, bro. Aiming at your head like a buffalo.
Bow.
You a roughneck, I'm a cutthroat. You a tough guy, that's enough jokes.
Damn.
Then the sun die, the night is young though. The diamond still shine, in a rough hole. What the fuck though,
yeah.
Where the love go?